was my 60th birthday. 60th. And Swami was speaking about that event for 1 month. Every alternate day was telling me, oh, you are going to have a birthday. Oh, I see. Anything. He was telling me. And it was in that season, two more celebrated their birthdays. One happened to be Mr. Balram, the Swami, he drives Swami's car, Balram. Other is Chiranjeeva. They were also born in the same month, October. So Swami, while talking to them, he segmented me. Oh, your birthday is on the same month, he was telling me. He knows. Exactly on birthday, I wore a new suit and sat there. Totally he ignored. He didn't look at me also. He simply passed by. I thought, all right, take it. Take it easy. Then in the afternoon I went inside. And then he gave me some gifts. But he did not make any reference to birthday. And in the evening, please believe me, in the evening, there you follow constant?
Yeah.
In the evening, I saw some fellows, young men, just climbing upstairs of staff quarters, moving up and down, very busy. I don't know who they are. Around 6 o'clock, they all came to me and said, we are going to celebrate your birthday. They are from Visakhapatnam. Not from this place. A surprisingly 300 people came. It was celebrated. That's how Swami works. And next day he said, what sweets you brought for boys distribution? Then I brought some sweets distributed for boys, marking the occasion. Why I'm telling you is, this year, October 25th, happens to be my birthday, this 25th. I was feeling so bad, had Swami been alive, in the physical form, things would have been different. Yes, things would have been different because he knows how I'm associated with his movement for 40 years, not 1 or 2 years. And he also blessed me the opportunity to translate his talks for 22 years. And he also gave me the privilege of writing his 26 books on Swami teachings. And he has blessed me with wonderful, wonderful, diamond-like friends, devotees, like Mr. Lucky, the leader of SaiWisdom.com website. Diamonds. And they have been helping a lot. And they have been recording. And they have been putting in the website. And all the messages are brought to the attention of devotees world over for the last 15 years. That's really marvelous. Baba's gift is what I think. And that website is available in 13 international languages. Not a small thing. Things have been going on like that. And I was feeling, had Swami been there, things would have been different. Because at that time, a phone call came from Hyderabad. They said, we'll celebrate your birthday here, you come there. So 24th night I left, went to Hyderabad on 25th. And 25th evening, there was a meeting in the premises of Satya Sai Vidya Vihar. It was presided over by State Trust Convener, Mr. Rangarao, and also the State President, Mr. Charan, and Director of Global Hospitals, Dr. Ratnakar, and Director of some other engineering factory, Mr. V.S.R. Murthy. 4 to 5 speakers spoke that day. It went on well. I never expected it. Then we had another meeting at a place by Mehidipatnam, Hyderabad. Mehidipatnam, they have got community halls. Each hall they charge about 1 lakh to hire per day. But that man happened to be Baba's devotee. And he gave free to our Sai devotees to finish it. And it was wonderfully decorated, as they do for any gala grand wedding. And the meeting went on very well, with Bhagavad presentations also. Then we had another meeting at Vanasthali from Hyderabad, which was totally spiritual, where they kept huge screens outside for the devotees to watch, because the mandir cannot accommodate all people. Somehow I could speak and things went on very well in Vanasthali Prabhu. And there is another meeting at Nachara, Hyderabad, which is also the birthday celebration. So instead of one celebration, Swami arranged four celebrations in Hyderabad. See how Swami raises. Really. And it didn't stop there. Then I went to Guntur, my native place, where there is a meeting in Satsai Vijayaniketan. Another meeting in Satsai Shanti Sudha, a temple inaugurated by Bhagavan Baba himself. From there, we went to Kavali of Nellore district. The Hindu tradition is that as one steps into 70 years, the couple will be remarried. Same couple who have been living together, they perform a marriage once again at the age of 70. And they have some hormones, spiritual rituals, praying for long life, healthy life, something like that. And those people arrange all those things. Right from morning 6, program started. It went on till 12 o'clock. 12 o'clock. Whole thing that related to marriages, every step, same thing. And then in the evening around 4 o'clock, Balakas meeting was held, attended by 400 Balakas children from different schools. At the end of the Balakas program, around 6 o'clock, at a public meeting was arranged, and the public meeting was very well attended. It was again a felicitation meeting. Interesting thing was, who had represented his friends, Mr. Lucky, Mr. Miguel, Sundaram, Ganesh, they are all from the Western world. And they watched it with keen interest. All are very happy about their presence. They are very excited about their presence and participation at these celebrations. And then I stayed there. Next day morning, Satya Sai Vratam was held. It was a truly personal one. But unexpectedly, other ladies came. They said, please tell us some spiritual matters. Okay. Then we started at 4 o'clock, reached here around 12:40 in the night. That was the end of the chapter of birth. And really unbelievable. They are all there in our website. You can certainly watch them. It's all Baba's grace. You see, whereas Swami must have thought, this fellow should not feel isolated, that this fellow should not feel deserted or frustrated. Now let me arrange series of meditations like that, so that he will be amply, adequately satisfied, far beyond my stretch of imagination. Saw Swami's grace. That's all things went on well. And interesting thing is, on the day of Satyanarayana Vratam at Kavali, on 5th, ladies who were all housewives, at the end of Vratam they said, you speak on spiritual matters. I have not heard people asking you like that. People ask me usually, tell us some experiences. Tell us your personal experiences. How Swami and you have come to Swami. They ask me. But there, ladies, speak on spiritual matters. I said, I am capable of talking on these things also. Then once I started, but I wanted to know their standard. Just I said, Baba says you are God. Baba says you are God. If you are God, why don't you know? You are God. Why don't you know that you are God?
No.
Huh?
I know.
You know. Why don't I know? Why everybody does? You know why? I asked this question. One lady, very simple lady, housewife, she got up and she said, mind is the cause. Correct reason. Correct. The mind, which is a curtain between you and God. So we are not able to know our true nature. Because I want to know their standard. So I put these questions. They answered them well. Though they are so simple ladies. Then second question I asked, what is true sadhana? What is true sadhana? Another lady said, a person traveling to himself, one going within, turn inward to find out his true nature, is sadhana. Correct. Like that, I put some questions and they give very intelligent, correct answers. Correct answers. That has given me breakthrough and excitement. I was happy about it. And then I developed the same subject on the same theme for some time. You see, this is gold. The ring is gold. Right? Earrings are? Waistbelt, gold. Necklace, gold. Gold is same, right? But you call this necklace, you call this ring. Why? You can say gold. You don't say that. Same gold, made into a jewel, fit into different parts of the body, get different names. A jewel made up of gold fit in the finger is a ring. Same gold made into a chain is a necklace. So gold is same. So similarly, God is gold. Necklace one gentleman, ring another gentleman, waistbelt some other lady. We are pieces of concretized consciousness. We are all pieces of concretized consciousness, divine consciousness. Don't you think so? Same wood, chair is made. Same wood, sofa is made. Same wood, table is made. Same wood. Wood is same. Similarly, divinity is same. God is same. But we get different names.
Will I ask a question?
Please.
Could you elaborate a little bit about Swami's coming, like about the book, that Kingdom Come? It's like where it's very clearly stated that he will come soon again in physical form. What is your...
To my knowledge.
Yes.
He made a reference to his next incarnation as Prem Sai. He also said the Prem Sai mission is preaching more divinity, spiritual work. Next incarnation, more. But for this, and he also said that the next incarnation is going to be in the state of Karnataka, near Mandya district. But for that, he has not said anything about next life. He has not said anything at what age he would show up himself to everybody. He has not said anything about the future. How much time do you take to come back? Yes, that's very hideous.
Did you read this book, Thy Kingdom Come?
Yes.
And where it says like he will be away for about 18 months to 24 months and then we might take the body again to fulfill his, that he says he will stay.
I heard a lot about it. But
you are the closest source, so I want to hear from you.
But to be honest enough, my mind doesn't go into that area of thought.
Okay.
Because I feel better we enjoy the present form, better we worship present form, better we involve in the activities of the present form, better we think of his teaching again and again, try to practice, that's enough. How am I bothered when he is going to come? How am I bothered whether he would recognize me or not? Right now, we are blessed with an opportunity, with his form, blessed with the privilege of serving him by participating in service activities. What more we want? That's my contention. What is it? You are from?
Chile.
New Zealand?
Chile. South America.
Oh, Chile. You were from Chile, came to the meeting arranged in Lima, Peru. And you?
Finland.
Good.
We just worked for 3 months in the Ukraine and spreading Baba's message over there. And he blessed us in the end with 6 days in a 5-star hotel for free. It was amazing. The whole journey being arranged by Big Boss.
Good.
It was amazing.
It is an experience. How do you like the trip? Good. How do you like the trip?
It was a divine trip.
It was like Baba says, red carpet treatment.
Oh.
Yeah? And it was like people offering us the biggest houses on the lakes, and it was like a grand happening. Like Baba walking everywhere in front and serving and bringing the people and big masses of people. It was amazing. Very good. Very good. In the work we did, you could literally, there were many Baba devotees. You could see Baba, like his energy, the smell, all of that.
Good. So happy about it.
Yeah, very, it was very beautiful.
Good.
Many people also come and it's very nice. And so it was like when we came back, I read this book about Thy Kingdom Come. That was like, that's a new perspective. You will see.
But it is left to the individuals to experience or to come to know the revelations, how divinity reveals to every person. It need not be the same. When you look at the cloud, some people will say that it looks like a tiger. Somebody would say it looks like an elephant. Somebody will say they look like mountains. A cloud, it looks in different ways to different people. How you look at it? So also, divine principle. With what maturity you look at it. With what experience you have. With what sadhana you look at it. These are all the points that gives the correct idea of the vision of Sai. Follow me. And it seems the birthday functions program is released, I believe. And we two
friends around.
And we two friends around. Birthday program has already been announced. So I too must have got it. I am forwarding to you. Yes. Anything you want to know? Ask the person.
Whatever your invitation process.
More questions? What Shiva? Is this your first visit? Were you here before? Which year, roughly? How many years ago?
First time 10 years ago.
10 years ago. Then what is the difference between now and then?
I feel more happy.
More happy now? More happy than then?
Yes.
What could be the possible reason? Possible reason?
I feel Baba more in my heart.
No. Then?
Then I was much in my mind.
Good answer. Very good answer. Very, very good answer. To see Swami physically, to experience Swami physically, to picturize Swami mentally, without feeling Him, experiencing Him, in the psychological domain, in the psychological level, at the level of the mind, but having gone deep within, having practiced to experience Him in our daily life, we will find Him in the heart. So as you said, people will have to feel Him now, at heart, particularly now, with His physical absence. Good, good. Well, what would you recommend further things to be done?
To find a person who already knows them. Like personally for me, like the biggest change in my life was because I met Rama, and he started just explain me like Swami's teachings about transformation. And it's all about looking at ourselves and letting go of the ideas of who we are.
Good answer.
I see that right now on you. When I see the devotees, the people around, there's a lot of confusion.
Yeah.
If we, from my perspective, if we do not see the confusion as negative, the confusion is something to take away all ideas, so Swami can take over even more. I see that a lot in Darshan right now. It's like people sit there, they don't know where to go, what to do. The form is gone. But in this confusion of not knowing, there's so much place for Swami.
What is the reason for confusion? What could be the possible reason?
The ought is gone. The ought is gone. The attachment to the form is gone. And so the mind cannot play the game anymore. It cannot say, Swami looks at me, so I'm a good person, I'm a bad person. Yeah, the whole attachment is gone. Yeah? So the mind is open. It looks for something. So where can it go? It can only go to Swami.
Correct. Correct, correct.
It has to go beyond projection. It has to go up. This is what I see is happening right now.
Good, good.
And only the faithful, they go in that direction. The others, they run away because it's too much of a challenge, too much openness. It has to go to Swami.
Correct, correct.
Thank you.
No, since you have been here for many years, what difference did you notice between now and then, when form is in our midst, and today, when the form is not in our midst, what difference is that?
When I came to Swami, He called me. I was thinking I'm coming for 2 months. The number two was right. It was one, and it was 11 years. Yeah. So it was like the number two was right. He gives always good hints. When I came there, I already had been like doing healing work all over the world for 10 years, and I thought, like, why are you calling me? And then after I've been here 1 month, I saw like I had no clue about spirituality. I had an idea, but I didn't have a clue. And that he gave me the experience, for 10, 11 years, what it means to be here and to believe in God and the Guru. So this has happened 10 years. After I've been here 7 years, he said to me, now you start to become workable material for me. I remember that exactly. I thought like, oh, so. Now without the form, he is there for us, as you say, only in the heart. There is no more game about, oh, he looks at me, I'm nice, he does that, he doesn't. He's only in the heart. And this guides us back into our I am, into our energy. Where Ramana says, God, Guru, and the Self is the same.
No.
And this is where
how
we
to feel him in heart.
How to feel him?
In my heart. How to feel him in my heart.
But he's there all the time. They're putting their attention there.
Attention on the heart?
Because he is the heart, he is the soul, he is the light.
What is the difference? Baba being in the mind, Baba being in the heart. What is the difference? I always think of him, he's always in my mind. In what way is that different from Baba in the heart?
The essence of Swami is here, and the education is through the spirit. Is through his teachings that is constantly available. He constantly tells us, yes, and he's in the mind. He's right in our heart. The essence is us. The essence of me is Swami. Essence of you is Swami. Everybody's essence is God. And then we have our experiences, and in these experiences, he helps us through our mind. This is how I perceive it like this. Everybody has different way of perceiving. This is how I perceive it personally. He corrects us, he teaches us, but correct. He approaches the mind.
As you talk to people inside, or as people talk to you, what is your main observation in their psychology or in their thought process inside? As you meet so many devotees, what did you notice in their thought process?
For me, the main interesting thing is when I worked in the centers in Malaysia, in the Baba centers, people came asking me, say, tell me something what Swami thinks about me. So Swami would tell me about the particular devotees. The main experience for me is that every aspect of life you give to Swami, you don't need to think about it. It's like Swami takes care of it. Let's say somebody comes and says, yes, my marriage was arranged by Swami. There is no problem in relationships. Yeah. But because he thinks about money, so his problem is with money. Then another person inherited the money. Oh, Baba was giving all the money to me. Yeah. I don't need to think about it. Yeah. So no problem with money. Yeah. So every person, the area of life, we do not fully give to Swami, we are still operating from our ego. In that area of life, we are still involved in the illusion. Everything we give to Swami, it's running perfectly without us, interfering at all. That's my experience. And whenever I see these people, I see, okay, look, this area you haven't given to Swami, this area you have not given to Swami. Yeah? So in that area, you operate from your mind, and this operator is problem. That part is problem.
But one thing that is, as I see, Narnarayan Guha there, Narnarayan Guha mountains, those people are still under the impression that Swami will come back. They still feel the bowl of food served to them every day.
But only thing is,
he says, Swami giving darshan in darshan hall.
I still felt him holding letters in his hand and he's walking amidst the crowds, blessing people and sitting in the chair of it. But it was just a feeling. I couldn't see it.
Correct.
A very strong feeling.
Very good. He has a strong feeling that Swami is moving there, carrying letters in the darshan hall. Very good.
Without the body, I feel lots of people told me actually that this energy is stronger without the body. It's more, they're sensing his presence even more than when he was with the body. That's what a lot of people told me actually. Actually, it was my experience too.
That they're
sensing
his presence
more.
See, that after a very young girl, he says, in the absence of physical form, they are feeling more of the divine energy than before. Second point, she says, she feels Swami carrying letters there in darshan line in Kulonha.
Many people in the Kuran hall are feeling different experiences. As seeing Swami, like she was mentioning, somebody see Swami sitting on the chair, somebody see different things at the same time. Can you explain what is this phenomenon?
I think you should excuse me. You should not feel hurt when I say that. Because it starts with difference of opinion, right from with my wife. Difference of opinion with my wife. I say, this way. I see Swami sitting in the chair. I find Swami moving over there. I see Swami standing in my front, in front of me. I feel that's all mental projection. And mind is totally involved in Swami. Mind is craving for Swami. Mind is waiting for Swami. Mind is longing for Swami. Mind is totally engrossed with the thought of Swami. Naturally, we feel him in the chair or moving in our minds. A little step higher, is to feel him in our heart. Why? Why? The mind may feel him now, after lunch, may not feel him, because it goes to rest, afternoon nap. In the mind you may feel during bhajan time. After dinner, you go to sleep. You don't feel him. So mind, experience of mind is not constant. Because mind is dual. Mind is dual. But whereas in the heart, it is non-dual. It is eternal. It is changeless. So initially, we experience him at the mind, at the level of the mind. Naturally, we get established in our heart. That's how we look at it. How to feel him at our heart? How to feel Swami in my heart? How to feel him? How I experience him at the level of the mind is clear. At the level of the mind, how I feel him? He appears in my dreams. I see him sitting in the chair. I see him moving in our midst. I see him looking at everybody. That's all experiencing Swami at the level of the mind. How do you experience him at the level of the heart? How do you experience Swami at heart? Afghanistan.
I think I experienced in the art set, because when I play, I don't have to put it on the chest. It's a big heart. I can see that small is strong. I think it's strong in my heart, so I look at my heart. So it's there. I don't have to look at a statue or a picture. So I don't think I'm already, in a way, experiencing in my heart as this. And also, I think we must excuse these people, because those of us who had the experience, Swami being in his physical form, and now he's not in his physical form, there is an interim period, an intermediate period for all of us who had seen his form. Now, for newcomers, their minds will not experience what these people are experiencing, seeing Swami in the chair and taking the letters. They haven't seen that. So they will not have those type of experience. So don't you think this is just a passing phase with people like us who've seen it before?
Correct. It's also correct what you said. This is an intermittent period. Physical form, formlessness. This intermediate period, reactions, changes of this sort happen. Natural. Slowly and slowly, as the days pass by, we experience it at heart. Now, the one who experiences him in his heart, in what way he expresses himself in his life as against a person who experiences him at the level of the mind. He experiences at the level of the mind. He experiences in heart. What is the difference between the two? In their day-to-day routine, in their day-to-day dealings, in their relationships. I am interacting with you. Is it at the level of the mind or is it at the level of the heart? How do you decide?
Isn't the level of the heart, wouldn't that be your constant integrated awareness? The level of the mind is also the passing thoughts.
You think that these are ordinary people? No one is ordinary. Everyone is extraordinary. Ganesh has given a very good answer. Constant integrated awareness. When you feel Swami in your heart, you will have constant integrated awareness. What do you mean by constant integrated awareness? Did I expect you here now? Did I expect you all here? No. Did you expect that we have satsang this morning? No. This had happened because of His grace. So awareness of His hand, awareness of His will, awareness of His presence, every time, everywhere, in all our daily life, is what is called constant, integrated awareness. This arises when we start feeling Him in our heart. But if it is at the level of the mind, it happens in the morning, may not be in the afternoon, it may happen in the dream, it may not happen when we wake up. Am I right? Good Spanish, what you said is correct. Any supplement you want to add? Am I right? You want to add anything what you said? You understand what you said? So. Oh, you understand? Is feeling to be understood?
Okay, I feel it.
I feel. Because feelings cannot be understood. Feelings will be felt.
Feelings what?
Felt. I feel is different from I understand. So, that which is felt is a feeling. But that which is understood is only an understanding. Feeling is higher than understanding. You can understand everything, but you may not feel. Simple thing. Suppose somebody say, which Anil Kumar house is a temple. Oh, it's very good, very nice. You can understand. But you may not feel the same thing as I say. I say that. And you may not feel it, though you understand it. So feeling is above, higher than understanding. Understanding is the mind, feeling is the heart. Feeling is the job of the heart. Understanding is the job of the mind. Understand? Am I clear?
Swami says, feeling is the language of the soul. That's a beautiful thing. If you tell me something, and it's truth, I feel it. If it comes from the mind, I can't perceive it. So the feeling is always that. We all feel Swami.
Correct. That's why when Swami speaks, it touches our heart, a feeling straight. Well, when one professor speaks, ah, what a level it is, what a scholarship it is, how many quotations he said, what Sanskrit he knows, what language it is, there is understanding. Whereas Swami teaching straight hidden in the heart.
But also, sometimes in the heart, I have a negative feeling. When you say feeling, so what about this negative feeling in the heart? Are we talking about which kind of feeling?
Yes.
Emotional feeling also we have. It changes. Sometimes it's up, sometimes it's down, sometimes. So which kind of feeling are we talking about?
Correct. Feelings are two things, positive and negative. Thoughts, positive, negative. This is how I look at it. I know you. You know me. The thought or the feeling depends upon the relationship between us. We are friends, so thoughts are positive. We are not friends. The positive thoughts are negative. So thoughts are based on our relationships. For example, in the mandir, I got so many people there around. Those who have tortured me, those who have criticized me, those that blamed me, those that are responsible for all the pain and suffering I had. I have negative thoughts. Because those fellows, I am a victim of their actions. I suffered at their hands. So I get negative thoughts. But whereas, the moment I come out of the hall, I stand before Ganesh. So many devotees surround me. You must remind them. There are innocent people from villages, not highly educated. Swami's devotees, I get positive thoughts. So, positive thoughts and negative thoughts depend upon the company we have, the relationship we have with the people. But that which is at heart is totally positive. That which is in the heart is totally positive. It is never negative. Simple example. The heart says, speak truth. Positive. The mind says, if you speak truth, you will lose money. You cannot do business. The heart says, be honest. The mind says, if you are honest, you will be failure in your life. The heart says, be straightforward. The mind says, if you are straightforward, you will be ditched. You will be ditched. Therefore, heart is always positive. It is value-oriented. It stands for conviction. Whereas mind stands for convenience. Mind is after convenience. Heart is the center of deep conviction. Am I clear?
This is what we love you for, because you always speak the truth. So you remind us of the truth.
That's what my friend Lucky also says.
Yes.
Anil Kumar, you speak truth. People expect you to speak truth.
That's right.
Come on, that's what he says.
That's right.
He always tells me, speak truth. People expect truth from you.
Yes.
Don't worry.
This is why you keep up satya right now in the ashram. This is why we need you. You are like the only one who doesn't go for the convenience, you go for the truth. This is what we need, and this is what we need your teachings for.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
It's important.
But in the process, brother, in the process, brother, willing or not, I had to suffer. In the process, I had to lose. In the process, I was restless. So the process, chiseling process.
I just want to say, only what suffers is the ego. It needs to be taken away anyhow.
Ah, yeah, anyhow, correct.
That what hurts is the resistance.
Yes, yes.
Yes. If you let go, you let go. So keep on speaking the truth. The truth takes away everything else.
Here you go. 100% I agree with you. Perhaps the hurt, the difficulties, the blame, and the pain we get from others is all around the ego, as he says. When one, and the ego has to be dropped somewhere, as he said. So when you drop the ego, you are not affected. You don't respond. You do not react. And how does ego go? By holding on to the truth. That's why Holy Bible says, ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. And once you know the truth, it will set you free. Free from what? Free from ego. Free from what? From pain. Free from what? From hurt, from blame, all the gimmicks of ego. You will be free from that when you are truthful and speak truth. Thank you. Good for you.
This is what I see over many years. I see so often, I don't know, people in the ashram, they hurt you. But you take it in, you let it work. You're not putting them away. Yeah, it's like you let it in, you suffer for some time, but then your truth comes out again, you know, and it's like, it just throws it off. You know, in this way, you're a very good example for everyone.
I think we also should look at it in the opposite. You see, I think now you are becoming more famous, and more people are being drawn to you because they're hearing slightly, maybe as you say, you are something, whatever it is. So more and more people are coming. You know, this is nature's way, this is God's way. Like when Jesus Christ was crucified by a few people. But what happened at crucifixion? What did he do? He drew millions of people to him. But if he was not crucified, he just stayed and it might have been different. So I think now it's to your advantage and to the advantage of the people really by being in this way. If nothing happened to you, maybe you could have been. But I'm only guessing.
I have one friend, ambassador, Indian Foreign Service. He was ambassador in Indonesia, ambassador in Malaysia, IFS, promised to work. Very good man. He has come to know the pain, the how I am hurt. He has come to know that. He has written what Ganesh has said. Anil Kumar, don't worry about this. Jesus was crucified. Jesus was betrayed by his own people, Judas Iscariot, and Peter, his own people betrayed him. And he was crucified. And out of this crucifixion, came the truth to the whole world, what the truth is. Therefore, this pain may lead to pleasure. The tears today may be the tears of joy. The pain inside may be a gain for expression of truth tomorrow. Who knows? Pain here may be a gain to express truth because you are already in pain. There is nothing to lose. Allow it to come. Let truth come out. Maybe I agree with Ganesh also. Maybe something good to happen. These things take place prior to that.
You speak from our experiences. I'm sitting here because of pain. look at the game of God.
Correct.
You know, as we pass through this life, you know, the pains that you have sometimes brings you to sit and talk to people like you. It's too painful.
The only thing to see is Baba takes out our pain, it comes in our consciousness, and then it goes out. This is why Baba draws us to get our garbage out. That's like so often people say, oh, Baba gives me pain. He never gives pain. He only gives us love and light, so our pain goes out. Baba is an eternal washing machine in that way. Only there for transformation. That's the thing, it's like we are coming here with all our pain, with our karma, and Baba graciously takes it out and takes it out. And wow. Some people complain and say, oh, I didn't have this pain before, now I'm with Baba, I have this pain. He brings it up, he brings it up.
Wonderful, wonderful.
That's all what we do.
Wonderful, wonderful idea. I fully agree with you. Fully agree. Because he said clearly, I will never make anybody suffer. I'll never give pain to anybody. He gave an example, a story. It seems Lord Krishna, you heard Krishna? Krishna was passing by one day and he saw a lady. That lady asked him, Krishna, this pot is heavy. I'm not able to carry it on my head. Would you please help me to lift this pot so that I can carry it on my head? Krishna said, I don't do that. Then while on the return, a lady was carrying pot on her head, another lady. Without asking, Krishna went there, brought down the pot from her head. Then the first lady asked, then I asked you, you did not do it. But for the second lady, without asking, you did. Why? Krishna's answer was, I am not here to put a burden on your head. I am here to take away the heaviness from your head, that burden from your head. I am here to unburden you, not burden you. Correct. So when he said, he'll never give you pain, that's what he was. And this is the story that he said. Another example he said, when there's bad smell here, if you keep it on a lock and key for a long time, naturally it gets a bad smell here. What do you do then? Light some incense stick, light some camphor, then you'll get good smell. Similarly, when one Sai thought enters into me, all the negative will get away, as you were telling. So to remove the negative, there should be positive. But we don't do that. We add, thank you sir very much. But what we do is, we add some more negative. There's already negative. You add some more negativity, with the result total negative. So, to reverse it, put it some positive thought. Very good. These are all spiritual thoughts, you know. This is not any story to talk about. This is not simple experience. I fell from the rickshaw. Swami helped me.
Swami said there is no pain, there is no gain.
There is no pain?
There is no gain also.
It depends upon the mind how you think. There is no pain, there is no gain. Correct. But it depends upon your mind. How you take it? Simple example. From this example. A thorn has gone into your toe. One person would feel, have I got my toe hurt? That thorn has pinched me. It's painful now. That's one thing. The other man will feel, good. The thorn has not gone into my eye. After all, toe doesn't matter. So what is the pain, what is the gain now? The way how you take it, the way how you react. Correct. One fellow will feel, I don't have car. another fellow will feel, I don't have car, but I have feet to walk. One fellow may feel, I don't have big mansion, big building, big luxury, three bedroom, four bedroom, six bedroom. Some people, I don't have that. Where other fellow will say, I'm happy, I have some shelter too. So pain or gain depend upon the way how you look at it. And second thing is, pain now may be a gain tomorrow. Gain now may be a pain tomorrow. Simple example. Some suffering, some disease, some loss in business, which is painful, might have brought you to the Swami. Oh, my suffering in the family level, or my loss in business, or my some problems brought me to Swami. So problem is negative, coming to Swami is positive. Problem is a pain, coming to Swami is a gain. Now what happens? Swami talking to you, gain. Swami giving you a ring, gain. Chain, gain. You become egoistic. You become arrogant. You think I am class number one devotee. What? You got ring, I got chain.
Prayers and prayers.
Yes.
Prayers, it starts out good.
And it's like that, correct.
Because it's selfish.
Prayers and prayers.
Prayers is long term, so it starts out bitter.
Prayers, priya, that which is dearing, endearing, shortcoming. Shreyas, which is long lasting. Shreyas, Bhagavad Gita words. Shreyas is the one which is long lasting. Prayers is one which is short term.
Like alcohol.
Swami giving me interviews, rings, good gain. But I develop some ego. And when he gives you, I am unhappy. He gives me ring. When he gives you chain, I feel unhappy. Why? So, a gain today may be a pain tomorrow. A pain today may be a gain tomorrow. So, there is nothing like total gain. Nothing like total pain. The way how we look at it. The way how we take it. Simple example. All my friends feel that I am a fool number one. Good. You call me fool number one, crack number one. Doesn't matter. Why they call me fool number one? I left my place at a time when I was earning so much of money. Earning so much of money at that time. I simply resigned because Swami wanted me to come here. Loss is very clear. And two, I came here at a time when my daughters are still in the medical school. Daughters need some personal attention. Son is studying engineering. Daughters are studying medicine. One daughter is studying her MA in English. Mother is 80 years old. I just left them and came because Swami wanted me to come. So people call me fool for the second reason. First reason, didn't bother about the income. Second reason, left my family people. Third reason, I have my own house there. Of course, a moderate, modest old house. I am living in a matchbox now. Staff quarters is a matchbox. If you go straight, this table will hit you. If you go this way, the teapot will hit you. If you go straight, sofa set immediately. If a guest comes, should sleep under the sofa. 18 years I'm living there. So, So they call me fool for the third reason. Fourth reason, they are correct because I know the reasons why they call me fool. I know the reasons. Fourth reason, Swami is not there physically. So I have no chance to be close to him physically. I have no chance to translate his discourses because he is not there to give any discourse. So they call me fool, why should you be there? Unemployed. Fourth reason. All these reasons are correct. Fifth reason, they call me fool again. These people are not giving me as much of respect. I don't demand, at least I deserve some respect. Why? Because I'm 70 years and 40 years of service in Swami organization, 22 years of translation, long period. You cannot be simply dropped like that. I'm simply dropped like that. Naturally, that makes all my friends feel so bad. So they consider me fool again to continue to stay here when you are totally neglected or dropped like a hot potato. My friends don't want to happen. I may not care it. My friends, well-wishers, they don't want such a thing to happen because they see me there. Why, sir, I tell you, for Swami's birthday, one day, you must have seen 1 year, you must have seen the cassette. Swami has chosen 4 people to put some oil on his head, marking the birthday. He has sent 4 names. Announce these names, they will put oil on my head, one couple after another couple. Thereafter, the proceedings. That's what he sent to word that year. The cassettes are available. And he has sent word through 4 people. Anil Kumar Javed to announce the names. Couple after couple walk to the dais, climb up the steps, put some oil, and then go. But Anil Kumar is not that fellow to do that. Any buffalo can do. What I did was this. I told Vedam. I told these people, I'll ask you to stop. I'll give you signals. They said, okay, sir. Then I gave introduction. It was the time of coronation of Lord Rama. Blessed are those who could witness the coronation of Lord Rama. And some saints were invited to put some oil on his head on the day of coronation. The same act is repeated here today. The coronation of Bhagavan Sri Satchai Baba. On the throne of our heart, in the kingdom of our life, Swami was happy. I don't want to keep quiet. Something, arrival of the train, departure of the train, arrival of the flight, departure. I didn't come on, not like that. I said those things. And then I asked the Veda people to start. They started Vedic recitation. I invited one couple. They put some flowers. They left. Then gave introduction of the next couple. Here are a couple who have been devotees of Baba for 5 generations. A very rare thing. They know Swami when right from the age of 17. When Swami was 17, they could know his divinity. I invited them. Ganga Dakshati. They came and kept some money. Asked the other fellows to start. What a flavor it has given. So my friends know my performance there. They feel so bad. When I sit there helpless, doing nothing there. That's why they are hurt. That's why my friends at home call me fool again on genuine grounds. Then earlier, if you care to see the cassettes, 23 years before I came to Swami, here, physically, what were the announcements? Kasturi used to make announcements. What were the announcements? There will be divine discourse in the evening at 5 o'clock in Purnachandra Auditorium. That was the announcement. But when Swami asked me to do it, what did he do it? Bhagwan Baba has graciously consented to deliver the divine discourse this evening at 4 in Purnachandra Auditorium. This is different from that. Then the divine discourse, is it a railway timetable or aircraft timetable? Graciously consented to deliver this. It's different from that. Don't you think so? Another time, in response to the prayers of the devotees, Bhagwan has graciously agreed to bless us, to bless all of us with the divine discourse. How do we like it? That's how I change it that way. So, but those...
A future great character. This is Bhava Sri Yu.
So when all my friends see me there silent, without any announcements, without any participation, how do they feel? They feel so bad. So they call me fool again. So they have so many reasons. And next, as Mr. Ganesh says, when the whole world wants me to go and speak about me, about Swami, why should you continue to stay there? Come on, go around and speak about Swami. Feel free, why should you continue to stay? So they call me fool again. My own brother, who is a director of Global Hospitals, Hyderabad, who was a professor all in medical science, top man, he is known all over the world as a leading pathologist. He wrote me, he sent me a mail, why do you waste your time there? Why do you cut short your life like that? You are losing weight already. Would you like to end your life faster than the scheduled time? Why do you want to be there? Some flights arrive before time. Some flights are delayed. Would your flight should be before time? That's what he said. So, I'm very unpopular today among my people. There is a pain. Naturally, I feel deeply hurt. But at the same time, I have some in a corner, some satisfaction. What is it? Here is food. You are hungry. If you don't eat, whose fault it is? Your fault. Food is here. You are hungry. If you don't eat, it is your mistake. Similarly, I am here available. I am here available. If you don't make use of my services, it is your mistake. Go to hell. Go to hell. It is your mistake. I am available. And people will know, out of jealousy you are not making use of yourself, my self. Okay. And in one corner I have some satisfaction. Why? Why? Service does not mean speaking and announcements, no. I just go around the devotees. I go walk to the end of the Purvodha and say, hello, how are you? There are people coming from villages. There are people who are innocent, illiterate, poor people. There are devotees who come and go. If I go, how are you? It's good to see you here. How do you experience Samadhi? Have you touched any Samadhi? How many days you are going to be here? They feel, Anil Kumar came and spoke to us. They feel very happy. I think I'm giving some joy to some people who come here from long distances by just inquiring their welfare. How they are keeping here. It is service. Service that gives me some satisfaction. and then some little feeling of satisfaction. Why? Because every Sunday I give a talk there, talk to devotees. And devotees from different states come here, youth, I can encourage them to take up Sai mission. And devotees from overseas, they come here, I love to talk to them. Some service is there, some satisfaction. So they feel that they are very happy that they could give me pain. But I am happy that I could have some gain by meeting devotees, by meeting people, by spreading joy to everybody. So life is a mixture of pain and a gain. Rose flower has a thorn. Thorn is a pain, flower is a gain. Alright, I take it that way. So I sent a mail to my brother. Don't worry. After all, my period of life does not depend upon Puttaparthi or Hyderabad or Guntur. It is decided long back. As Baba says, every life is a medicine. There will be two dates. Date of manufacture, date of expire. Do we know the date of manufacture, date of birth? We don't know the date of
expire.
He knows. But both the dates are printed on the line. So why do you bother about it? It's already decided. Don't worry. I'm sorry, I spoke about myself. Don't mistake me that I'm blowing my trumpet. I think I'm not blowing my trumpet. I exposed what all that is contained in my heart. That's all.
Very beautiful. Thank you.
Because I have taken you to confidence. I have taken you to confidence. And I love you. And these things I cannot share in public. There are many things we can't share in public.
That is true. Speaking about your own personal experiences, speaking truth is being God.
This is truth, what he says.
What you say?
But speaking about my personal life like this is truth. That's what it's
very
Vakshuddhi. The purity of thought. Beautiful word. Good. She noticed flower falling from Swami's picture.
When you are telling about your experiences.
So, sir, now what happened? We went to Hyderabad, Satya Vidya Vihar. And I'm nobody now, no position. I have no position. Even from the university, I came out. I'm not even an honorary professor. I have no post in the organization. I'm nobody. But they organized such a big meeting in Hyderabad and celebrated my 70th birthday. And projected some pictures of my pictures with Swami from 1978. Some photographs with Bhajan's background. I was wondering, is it true or not? Was it I that had photo with Swami in the 78 with a curling hair? How is that I am growing bald now? Was I really handsome? Today I am awful, not that handsome as I was. So I was so happy, enjoying like others, like a spectator, a witness. And then when people are saying, you did that, okay Swami, you are praising, all right. A fellow is deeply hurt, now you are applying some jandu balm to make him painless, or you are applying some, what do you say, Barna. When it's burning, they apply some ointment, Barna, so that you don't feel burning sensation. So all these beatings are like Barna or Jandu Balm, so that there won't be any more pain. That's what they felt. Because usually people are felicitated, are praised when they are in position. You are now state president. They will praise you. your state trust convener, they praise you. You are very close to Swami, they praise you. And none of these today. Still they could have some meeting in Hyderabad, Guntur, Kavali. Why? Because of Swami. They don't. See, as individuals, they praise only who are in position, who are in power. I'm not in power or in position, I'm not in property in land. I'm my account in bank account is name. You can check. Swami always called me Vil Kumar. Always called me Vil Kumar. And true to his word, I am Vil also. Very good. Then why should they celebrate in such a grand way? As normal, average human beings, they don't do that. They do it to a rich man. They do it to a man in position and power. I don't agree. Why should they do it? He made them do it. Why did he make them do it? He knows I am feeling the pain. He knows that I am deeply hurt. He knows that unexpected things are happening. And my own brother was surprised that what's all going on. I said, you are feeling sorry for me now. Now you see and enjoy. So that you don't feel any more sorry for me. That's what he told. So, Lord has got his own ways. That's why God is comforter. God is the one who consoles, cajoles, advises, supports. That's what I find his hand at every step for the last 10 days. I'm so glad that I could share these things. Because I was telling my good friend Lucky, he gave me a phone call yesterday. Mr. Anil Kumar is going to be satsang tomorrow. I told him, sir, people don't know whether I'm in station. Because I'm out of station for 10 days. So I'm not sure of people coming for tomorrow satsang. But anyway, I'll be able. And he said, yes, we can talk among ourselves, he said. And I never thought this satsang would take place with the truth coming out, speaking about personal life. I'm so happy. This is constant integration awareness. This is the feeling from the heart. It is not from the mind of convenience. It is the heart of the conviction with which we started our satsang this morning. Heart and the mind.
The world that we live in, actually it's a very fickle world. The thing is, it's like fan following. One minute you're a hero, next minute you're down in the dumps. Like one hit wonders, they say. Chiranjeevi, Bada, hero. Like, Baad mein kuch bhi nahi. But God's love is constant. That's the only thing that's true. People will come and go. Their attention is very fixed, you know. They come, they, at one time you're like so much luminous, shining on top of you. Next minute you're nothing.
You follow what she said? You are hero in the morning, zero in the evening. Public will praise you at one time. Public will condemn you later. But God's love is constant. He loves you forever and ever. Good.
So we have to make a choice always. Between the world and God. It's always a choice. We have to remind ourselves not to fall in that illusion. See them only as reflections of God, nothing else.
What is her age? What philosophy she is speaking?
Pain is the best teacher.
Pardon?
Pain is the best teacher.
Pain is the best teacher.
Sometimes.
Is my pain turned into a teacher?
Pain is a force. Your pain, as far as I see, now is changing your blessing. See, when you praise the rich and the mighty, that's hypocritical, not sincere. The people who are coming to you now are the sincere, honest people. So your name now is going to go.
The pain make you a better teacher.
Better?
So he's improving you. Even the satsang are improving after your pain.
I mean, we all are looking for love, right? That's what we get a lot of heartbreak from people, but God never takes your heartbreak. That's
That's what he said. God never gives you heartbreak. There are people who give you heartbreak. Good. And he says, this is making me a better teacher. And he also feels some improvement in the quality of my presentation.
Just like before, Baba was giving you so much energy and you were always on top. Now he drops you into yourself, so now your heart comes out, your life comes out, and it's you. This is a beautiful thing. It's a new beautiful beauty.
So happy.
Yes.
But what we are talking now, we cannot speak in public in a large gathering. Supposing Sunday meeting. Can I say these things there? No. Because they expect something different. Nothing to do with the personal. How could I do it here? Because you are close to me personally. There, they are close to me, dais, audience, relationship. Here, person to person.
I think, Anil, you underestimate the people. Because I think everybody, even on Sunday, even there are 150 people, they all come because they love you. They're not only coming because you are Baba's translator. Yeah? Everybody gives their time, and I think in this part, like everybody sitting here, everybody who is there, they come because they love you.
So you mean to say, this audience and that audience make no difference? I see. Good.
Because I see,
it's good to know that.
You are spreading your heart, you are spreading the truth, and it touches the heart and the truth of everybody. And I see that also in the people who come there, who like you when you are the translator, but you're always giving from yourself. You always give from yourself. Yeah? And that's the beautiness of it. And this is what the people in the ashram are jealous of. It's a, you know, it's just like, it's Anil special, it's you. Yeah? It's like Baba through you and you. You know, you never hesitate, you always speak the truth. So don't underestimate the people coming.
Thank you for this revelation.
I know.
And timely correction. Because I think outside people, we are connected. Something like the man as a speaker and the audience. No personal. But here, since few of you are here, is a personal eye-to-eye contact. But now you tell me that and this makes no difference.
It might not be with everybody, but I would say in your, how you perceive it, you underestimate the love of the personal Anil.
I stand corrected happily.
Good. I know you will go there.
Well, because you are correct, because I never expected those ladies in Kavali next today. Ladies, very simple, humble housewives, telling me you speak on spiritual topic this morning. I never expected that they would give such high answers, equal to the level of the questions. I never expected. So I underestimate them, and I was to be corrected. So I corrected myself there. Now you say, I'm underestimating these people and happy to be corrected for the second time. Because life is a process of learning and unlearning. So I'm glad that you're helping in the process of learning.
Lucky calls you yesterday, if you give satsang in the evening yesterday evening, Baba sent me and said, ask Anil to give satsang tomorrow. Oh. Okay, I sneaked in yesterday into your house, I asked you. You know, and you say, let's see how many people show up. You see again. You know, so you're on this divine washing machine all the time. It's working from all parts. And this is what we know from Swami. Pure love. Until you fully surrender to Him. Nothing else.
Good. And you call it washing machine. And as Swami calls it, workshop. Workshop. All cars, automobiles, under repair, go to workshop.
Yes.
Swami says, Prashantilam is a workshop. All those damaged vehicles come here. I repair and send them so that they will run well. And you call it my washing machine to remove the dirt collected over our souls. And the dirt is the world, and the dirt is dualism, the dirt is attachment, selfishness, washing machine.
All our karma.
All those were different types of washing machines. Different types. Even those people who gave their rings and the bangles and changed to were washing machine people. Not necessarily they were saints. They could have been sinners.
So for their self-improvement, yes. This gift must have been given. Who knows? When Swami gives a ring to a miser, when he gets the ring, come on, he becomes a man of sacrifice later. Washing machine. A man of ego. When Swami gives me change, he'll understand what life is. He may start being humble from there. So it will be washing machine. But if it leads to pride, then it is a pain and not a gain. Good, good. I think this satsang is lucky, is really something deep, because of your presence, and thank God for sending you and making this morning very meaningful, very special.
Sorry, Tanu. Sir, one thing, when Krishna Gautam Mitra Rama, when Krishna Bob, Chisthana Rama and Bob, there was an atmosphere completely fierce, and there was joy in everything. Krishna was of course nature. But when they are leaving the body, okay, they say Krishna left the body, they say one arrow was thrown down, hunter like that. Why they reach such a pathetic state, just like Jesus Christ and left the body? In our Swami's case also, yes.
Can you repeat the question?
His question is, when avatar, our noble souls, are born, there is festivity, there is celebration. There is joy and bliss all over at the time of their birth. But when they leave the body, it was very painful and it was tragic. Why? That is the question. The answer is simple, because it looks tragic to you, not to them. Jesus on the cross was happy. While those of us who were watching him, crucifixion, it was painful. It was happy to him. Why? Because he prayed, "Oh Father, excuse them. They do not know what they do." So those noble souls while leaving may look tragic and painful to us, but to them it is not. Why? Because they decide the way to leave. They know, they decide how to leave the body. Whereas we don't decide the way how to leave. We may leave while on bed. We may leave out of suffering. We may leave in accident. We may leave premature. We may leave at an young age. It goes by karma. Whereas noble souls, avatars, do not live by their karma. They live by their will, sankalpa. They know how to live. So it's not tragic to them. It looks tragic to us. It looks painful to us because our physical attachment. We are so painful when Swami is not with us. But he is not painful. Because he wanted to live and he left. We are feeling painful because of physical attachment. To him he is not painful, because he is the spirit and he is not the body. So he is the spirit. So you are the life, I am the life, I am the spirit, says the Holy Bible. I am the life, I am the spirit. So he is the spirit. So spiritually, he is the spirit, so he is not tragic. But we are physically attached, so it is tragic to us. Am I clear?
Sir, another question. Just like before leaving the body, Ramakrishna Paramahamsa three days I will give this body to the Ramakrishna. And many Shri Mahatma Prabhupada's sage names are there. Before 45 days they say, Vinayi, keep it like body for 45 days. But Swamiji, this thing never happened.
His question is, all noble souls said when they would leave. Will you, Ramakrishna Paramahamsa, he said, I am leaving. Vivekananda, he said, I am leaving. So all those people said the day of their departure, the day that they would be leaving. Why not Baba? Why did he not say? My imagination. Baba didn't say anything, it's my thought, subject to correction. Those people to whom they said, I am leaving, are limited people, two or three. Today, because of internet, because of cell phones, because of communication, instant communication, if he says, I am leaving, 10,000 people may commit suicide. Because the devotees are there all over the world, they cannot take the shock. So, he did not announce out of his concern, out of his love for his devotees. Those days, Paramahamsa told Vivekananda, that's all. He did not go to the neighboring village. But today, if he says here, he will go to Argentina within seconds. So, those people will die. Because of heartbreak, so he didn't do that. Because we are living in the days of mass communication. Okay, sir. Shall we go?
One more question. Is there is any instance in Swami, when Swami was in the hospital, that show that he was not suffering, he has no pain? Because you said they don't have pain when they pass away. Is there any anecdote there? That he showed that he was not in pain during the treatment?
Yes. This is my personal experience. I got thousands of chances to press his feet, many chances. For 4 years, I dined with him lunch there in the Purnachandra Auditorium. Somehow he loves my father's seva, pressing his feet, because I got used to it. Pressing my feet of my mother. When she comes from her office, she used to have pain. So I used to do massage. So he liked it. So whenever I go, he put like that, I massage. Believe me, I stretched my hand up to joints. Up to this stretch my hand. While doing so, I know how soft his body is. Softer than butter. Softer than rose petal. Why? Because one day I did over action, pressed it more, a little more, thinking that Swami is comfortable. That evening Swami could not get down from the bed. All blisters. It took some time for him to come out. Next day he said, Anil Kumar, yesterday I am undone. You pressed it too hard. All blisters see that. I started crying. Then he said, don't blame yourself. You are talking, I am enjoying your talk. So, it was going on something that had its effect next day, he said. So, conclusion is, his body is so soft, tender, delicate, sensitive. My question is, such a sensitive, tender, soft, delicate body, how could it withstand injections, hundreds of injections. How could it withstand pacemaker fixation? How could it withstand the lungs problem? Lungs problem. What they call it, what do you call it? Pacemaker there? And ventilators. How could it withstand ventilator? Yet jaundice there, liver problem. How could that body withstand? I know it's so soft like cotton wire. My conclusion is, he must have left the body to the care of doctors and he must have been holidaying going around all over the world, visiting his devotees, blessing them, asked them to do whatever they like, and he decided when he wanted to go. And he left on the day when he decided. Not decided by doctors, not decided by the treatment. No. Since you all have come, come and take care of me. I'll take care of my devotees. I'll get out of the body when I want. That's how.
Swami always used to say speeches and books also. How person is living is not important. How is going to live this body is important. The what way the body was left is so pathetic and because couldn't explain, couldn't deserve so.
You follow his question or should I repeat? He said, quoting Baba, that the way how we live is not that important. The way how we leave the body is more important. That's what he said. Correct. It's correct. Bhagavad Gita also says that. But my point is, this applies to all of us. This rule applies to all of us. So that we'll be careful while in life. Because the care, the charity, the service that we do while in life will take care of the end of our life. The end of life. So that we'll be careful now. It applies to us. Because we live and leave. But God does not live, does not leave. He is ever present. He is ever present. He is not living for some time, leaving later. He is not like that. He is life. He is not living. He is life. He is cosmic energy. But the body is something like a bulb to give you light. That's all. But electricity is continuous. So similarly, the end, he has no end because he has no beginning. So the one without a beginning, without end is God. The one with the beginning, with end is human. He has no beginning, he has no end. So his end does not decide the next life. His beginning, his living does not decide the end. Because he is beyond the beginning and the end. Why? He decides when to come. He decides when to go. How to go. So he is not in our hands, in our life. Am I clear? Thank you, sir. Shall we close? Which I would have hesitated to say elsewhere. Thank you. I am enriched by this association. Thank you.
Thank you so much for not seeing the few people as not being worthy of your presence, but speaking to us. Thank you so much.
No, I thank you. I love you. I know you very much since long. And you are not a man of today. I
know how we know each other. From past lives.
Oh.
But at this point, I don't dare to tell.
They know.
I don't tell you right now.
స్మరణం సాయి రూప ధ్యానం. సాయి నామ స్మరణం సాయి రూప ధ్యానం సదా మాకు ఇహ పరల నొసగు సాధనం. సాయి నామ స్మరణం సాయి రూప ధ్యానం సదా మాకు ఇహ పరల నొసగు సాధనం. సాయి నామ స్మరణం సాయి రూప ధ్యానం.
సదా మాకు ఇక పరాల దోషపు సాధనం.